Welcome back. My guests, Professor Sipho and Tinyiko Maluleke. We're looking at the State of the Nation address by President Cyril Ramaphosa. It's not only the talk that we're looking at, but the ability to deliver on the promises that have been made. Now, are there any short-term goals that you believe the president can achieve that can give the nation confidence that indeed he's onto something here, Professor Seepe?
Yeah, I think there were two comments that emerged from. One is a criticism that was leveled at him by Malema, and that has to do with the business. He says that we have been told that the President Ramaphosa has got an influence on the business, but the very same people that he talks about, that he seems to rely on, have been retrenching workers on a daily basis, that you cannot go and bring them and talk to them and then say, guys, we have to bring to build South Africa together, to grow the economy, and then they continue to retrench. So that is something that the president needs to address, because the very same people that are supposed to be closer to him, that people say influence him, whether it's right or wrong, are not playing the ball. So that's the first thing. The second one, which I thought was pretty good in his response, was a realization that you cannot rely so much on external people, especially investors. That one of the things that you need to do is to make sure that the local business and investors invest in the economy. Because if the local people don't invest in your own economy, if they have no confidence in your economy, the people from outside will not be. So effectively what he did was to simply indicate that there will be stimulus into our economy. The whole notion of emphasis on infrastructure and fixing of whatever is broken. Because the criticism that emerged also from business was saying, instead of dreaming about things of the future, let us deal with what we have. Instead of talking about or thinking about the bullet train, why don't you fix the current trains that we have? Why don't, instead of thinking about a new city that is smart, why don't you fix the current state of municipalities? Mm. Because that's where the many businesses find that the government is wanting. So he spelled that out in his response, effectively simply saying, I hear you, the opposition, and I embrace you, and what you say is not antagonistic to what I say, it's actually supplementary and complementary. So we will try to pay attention to that.
I agree with you. I understand what you say, Prof. And the interesting thing is that in this very week, as we're talking about what the president said, the numbers, the information that's been coming out is very, very bleak and negative, right? I mean, the retrenchments, the report by the Auditor General, for instance, and the fact that some of the parastates or the state-owned entities cannot pay salaries on time, the municipalities that cannot pay salaries on time. That tells you that the system is somewhat broken, and that is what he's inheriting. Now, the things that have got to happen going forward, particularly on the economic front, it's going to be a bit difficult if the municipalities who commission work from smaller players are not able to pay their own employees. It means there's not much work that is being given to those business people.
You know, one can summarize the most scathing aspects of the criticism to his Sona in this manner. Let's get the basics right. Let's just get the small things, the seemingly small things, to work. Let's get the municipalities to do what they are supposed to do. Let's get the trains to be operational. Let's get the squatter camps serviced adequately. So it is those basics that people are saying, listen, we want the smart cities, we want the bullet trains, but there are so many basics that are dysfunctional. And that's why the economy is not growing. And the economy is not growing, or if you like, it's a vicious cycle. It's not growing because of this, but these things are happening because the economy is not growing. Mm. And he needs to come in and break that vicious circle. So one of the short-term things I think that he needs to do is simply to go back to the basic, the simpler things that are not functional in this country, which is what many people in the country are complaining about.
But he doesn't have room to do that. I mean, if you talk about municipalities, what can he do about municipalities that do not comply with what the Auditor General has said should be done, the ones that are basically broken and dysfunctional.
Yeah, Tim, I think the issues are not that complex. If you look at the municipalities, and we have actually very enabling legal framework, all you need to do is to make sure that the structures that are supposed to be there are there and they are functioning. And if they're not functioning, you remove people. So it requires simply that. You need to make sure that the schools are functioning. And what it means is that the teachers must be in class, and they must be teaching, and there must be textbooks.
But, Prof, you know, I recall a speech made by former President Thabo Mbeki, I think, to that effect.
Yeah.
I think it was 2001 or something. Mm. In East London, when he actually said we need fewer people who can do the work than the number that we have now who are not doing the work.
No, I remember that well. Yes. But let me give you an example.
Yeah.
Some time back, we had teachers who were protesting, not wanting to go to class in Gauteng. And the current minister was the MEC at the time. And what she did was to call the community to say, I have difficulty. And the communities then said, if those teachers remain outside, we don't want them anymore. That cut the notion, and that was the end of that strike. So the president could use the message of we're in this together and this is our future. You rally, you don't rely on sectoral grouping that you talk to the unions, you talk, make sure that the nation rallies.
You take the nation with you.
Take the nation with you. And the nation will make sure that it happens. So, like it did happen, that they said those teachers who don't want to teach, we don't want them. And when the people realized that the communities, that those teachers, the community is very angry, they realized that they cannot hide because they have to go to those. But secondly, as my money indicated, we need to make sure that the black schools function because that's where the majority is. This is why it's actually proper that the Minister of Human Settlement and Water Affairs has actually said, come up with a very ambitious plan to say we will deal with the pit toilets in our schools and wherever they are. We need that type of thing because it's something that people will support.
Yeah,
so rally the people, and but again, it comes down to little things. And if they are little, they are doable. And you build success on those.
Well, politics is something else. I mean, I'm thinking of the report by the Auditor General, which shows that the majority of dysfunctional municipalities are in the Free State, for instance, and then the ones that seem to be more functional are in the Western Cape. They occupy two extremes. And the premiers of the two provinces, former premiers, on one side, Helen Zille of the DA, who is publicly attacked and criticized all the time for her remarks on Twitter.
She does her own attacking.
And she does respond, of course, very feisty person that she is. On the other hand, the former premier of the Free State is now in charge of the ANC as the secretary general, and 100% of municipalities there are said to be dysfunctional. What does it say about South African politics then?
Well, I mean, local government is clearly the Achilles heel of South African governance. And I think that President Ramaphosa will have to look at that, because as long as local governments and municipalities are dysfunctional, it doesn't matter where. I mean, we will not achieve the national goals that we talk about. Now, I heard you say, what can the president do about that? He can do a lot, because ultimately all governance rests on his shoulders. But he also needs to inspire. I mean, talking about dreaming, he should be inspiring premiers and director generals and city managers to dream of a different city than the one they run now, which is dysfunctional. So in other words, his dreams should be linked. He should be inspiring, setting the tone, inspiring people to work in a functional municipality and a functional city. That's the sort of dream
accept. There's a sentiment in South Africa that some of the people that are in charge of those places should not be there in the first place, that they should be in jail.
Get rid of them.
And the question that people are asking is that, given the amount of public information about the rot and corruption that's taken place in SOEs and some of the municipalities, why are these individuals not arrested and not in jail at this time? Is it a function of the hollowed-out state that we've heard about. I mean, when Shamila Batoi was appointed as the NPA chief, there was a lot of excitement in the air that some of the cases that we've heard about that were exposed at the Zondo Commission and elsewhere were going to be followed up. It's what, 4 or 5 months down the line, not much has happened. What's going on there?
Yeah, I think we should also be fair to the president. We live in a consumer democracy. And the president cannot be seen to be instructing what the law enforcement agencies are doing. All he can do is to provide the support that is necessary in terms of resources. But he can't be seen to be interfering. And there are people who listen to the Zona Commission and say, why are these people not arrested? If there's an issue of criminality, then the hawks, the NPA, the police must follow it up. But it can't be the president who sits in there. All he has to do is to provide a framework where okay. that is actually possible. Because if he does that, then people will see all the prosecutions as politically motivated. So you do not want to get to that stage. But also, justice does not work as quickly. And there are times when judges themselves disagree about what is actually right. Remember, if people were to go according to political sentiments and the media sentiments, the judgment that came today from the Constitutional Court would have been different. It would have seen the back of Mukwege and Jiba.
I have to squeeze in this question. It's got to do with ANC politics now. There's a generally held view that there are big tensions between the Secretary General and the President, that as long as they do not see eye to eye on what needs to happen, and of course there's the cloud hanging over the Secretary General of the ANC, Ace Magashule, that not much is going to happen. How much of an effect do you think Ace Magashule is in terms of the performance as president by Cyril Ramaphosa?
Look, I think the problems are bigger than the personalities, the ANC problems, and I think they are better understood outside the frame of Magashule or Mabuza or Ramaphosa. And the way I understand them, for example, take the issue of land or the issue of the Reserve Bank where they are supposed to have had disagreements. The ANC has got conference resolutions. The problem is that the ANC is unable to speak coherently to its conference resolutions, that they have not found a way to talk about it in a coherent and similar manner. So you have Mboweni saying one thing, you have Magashule saying another, you have the president issuing a statement from his office as ANC president, which is quite unprecedented. And so the same thing applies to land. Until the ANC finds a way of speaking coherently to its own resolutions, we will go on isolating individuals and saying that person and that person is a problem, that person is a problem. The problem is there is an ANC which is unable to cope with its own resolutions. And once they have the resolutions, to speak about them in a coherent and unified manner, not to be disagreeing about their own resolutions, even the approach to how they are going to do it. So that's what needs to be solved, first and foremost, because Ace Magashule, Cyril Ramaphosa, all these people will come and go. But unless a mechanism is found by the party to deal with its own resolutions coherently, we'll just have a change of characters. The problem will persist.
Well, and of course, the impact of those problems on the broader nation are being felt, as we know, at this time. And Professor Seepe, thank you very much. And Professor Maluleke, thanks again for having been with me. Of course, we can go on and on and talk about this, but the issues continue to emerge, so we'll have another chance to have a conversation on our country's challenges. That's all we had time for on the Modise Network, and thank you for having been our guests and joining us and sharing your views with us. I'm inviting you to be with us again next week. From us, enjoy the rest of the day.